My 13th episode of Hollywood in the Park. Again, I always like to thank everybody for joining me. And today on our spotlight is Miss Lucia Solis. Thank you, Lucia. Thank you for coming. And beautiful daughter, Lena.
Hi. Is that camera?
So, the reason for this episode is I wanted to bring her. I was actually going to get another guest on my show to show the side of the abuse women go through. There's abuse in women, there's abuse in men, there's drugs, alcohol, there's molestation. And I actually had somebody on my show before that talked about molestation, but in a male sector of molestation. So what I wanted to do is I wanted to bring a story of Lucia that actually is very, very heartfelt, but not only that, was very brutal in my aspect. Now, before I brought you on, the very first thing I asked was, is it okay, right? I asked you actually a few times, are you sure? Is this okay? Because it's a very, very emotional story about you. And I wanted to make sure it was okay, right? Yeah. Because, you know, a lot of people see, like me, see your daughter, see anybody in general, right, a certain way. And then, of course, after they hear our story, like, what? You know? So, but I wanna commend you for coming out and being brave to tell your story. Because when I heard her story, the very first thing I said was, there could be somebody right now going through this. At the age of 17 or 18 or 19 or 21 years old or 30 or 40 or 50, and thinking, you know what, I don't have any hope. You know, there's nothing for me to do. There's nowhere for me to go. You know, but see, you're at the end of the rainbow now, you know, that beautiful.
Glory to God.
Exactly. At the end of the rainbow where you can say, you know what, golly, back then you thought it was like over, right? So I want to start with, let's start back with your mom and dad. Tell me a little bit about your mom and dad.
Well, my mom and dad were really kind people. They were always inviting people over the house. They were very giving people. I remember that they would allow people to stay at our house, like relatives that would come from Mexico to start a new life here.
Oh, that was nice of them.
Yeah, they would let them stay at our house, you know, so they can get a job and get started, you know, and then they would move on, you know, and, you know, they both worked. She was from Durango and he was from Chihuahua. Mm. You know, then I had a brother and a sister, an older brother and a younger sister, you know, and that was mom and dad, you know, and it's not until one day, that they invited somebody to come and stay.
Who were those people?
That was my my uncle. He was an uncle of mine.
Did he come by himself?
He came by himself. He left his family in Mexico, and he came by himself. And
like a lot of other people.
Yeah. So it was nothing strange to us. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And it was just a matter of time before you know. It's like evil came into the house.
And how old were you at that time?
Seven.
Oh, wow, seven years old.
7 years old.
So when you say evil came, what do you mean by evil?
Because he started showing, you know, like he would start like kissing me, you know.
Like, kissing you? Like
kissing me, like, you know.
Like on the cheek or something?
No, on the lips. On the lips.
And where was your mom and dad?
My mom and dad worked nights. They worked nights and he was the babysitter.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and I remember telling my mom at one point that, because my dad and he had gone to a bar and they got into a fight. And when they came back, my uncle was all full of blood. They beat him up, and I remember telling my mom, you know, that I was glad that they beat him up. And she says, you know, well, you know, how can you say that? You know, and I said, I don't like him. And she's like, why? And I said, because he kisses me on the mouth like grown-ups do, you know. And
like grown-ups, like, what do you mean?
French like kissing, like you could,
he put
I
your
could
tongue.
Feel his tongue, yeah. Oh, God. And, but she kind of brushed it off, and she says, you know, you don't know what you're saying, you know, and go play.
And she probably thought you were watching too much TV or something.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And so I just, you know, from there, it's like that was the first and only time that I had said it to my mom. She didn't listen to me. And another time was my dad. One time he came into my room, my uncle came into my room and tried to fondle me, and I knocked over a lamp. And my dad came in, you know, and he said, what's going on? And I said, you know, he was trying to, you know, fondle me. And my uncle said, no, she had a nightmare, and I came to see what she was doing, because, you know, what was happening, because she knocked over the lamp. And so my dad's like, just go to sleep, you know. And so
they believed him.
They just brushed it off. They believed him, yeah.
Because you were having a nightmare.
Yeah, you know. And so what ended up happening is the abuse, you know, escalated from there. You know, it got worse, and it got worse, and it got to it was rape. Which rape, you know.
He started. In other words, he had sex with you.
Yeah.
And your mom and dad were gone at this time?
My mom and dad were...
That must have been terrible. That just
they
like,
worked nights. And I remember coming home from school, and when school let out. You know, back then, it was funny because back then they had prayer in school. Prayer was still in school. And it was something that... I didn't know God, but it was something that I really looked forward to, mm-hmm. because it gave me hope. You know, that somebody stronger was out there, you know, and that someday somebody would help me.
And shoot him.
Yeah.
How many of us would pray for that,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
That the evil would just die, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so I really look forward to that. And then whenever school would let out, I would stall and stall as much as possible. My brother and sister would always leave me at school because I just stalled so long, you know, didn't want to get home. I didn't want to get home, you know, because we lived on some apartments to where downstairs we had, there was a store downstairs. So what he would do is he would give them money to go downstairs and then leave me alone with him, you know, and he would say, oh, I left my pants in the restroom. Come with me and I'll give you some money, you know. I'm a kid, you know what I mean? And after a while, I started catching on to it, and I'd be like, no, you know, no. I don't want no money, you know. And I remember this one incident, and it's hard for me to talk about this because, you know, I don't want anybody to think that my parents were monsters because they didn't listen, you know, or because of the things that happened. You know, sometimes as parents we're just too occupied, you know. I don't know the reason why, you know.
And you know what it is, and I'll tell it for you, Lucia. It says us as parents don't want to believe that an actual person that we trust, a sibling or a cousin or a relative of ours, would actually hurt our child, right? And they want to believe that we were having a nightmare. Because how many times, honestly, everybody, have you had a child that said, oh, there's monsters in the closet, and it's because they watched too much TV, right? Or I had a nightmare that somebody was killing somebody, right? And it was just a nightmare, right? So obviously they want to hear that, they think that the child is not making up stuff, but maybe it was a nightmare. And then how are they supposed to, and it's like our parents want, unless they physically seen it. So tell me, did your parents actually finally physically see this?
I think I was probably about 30 years old, believe it or not, when we went to go visit this family, and I had told my mom, and I said, watch, the next time we go visit them, watch. And so we were in their dining room, and because he had 12 kids and my aunt, and I loved my aunt and my cousins, and And he began to say, you know, oh, mija, do you remember when I used to give you guys money for candies? And I said, yeah, I remember. I remember like it was yesterday. And then he says, oh, mija, and he reaches over and he grabs me and he grabs my breast.
Oh.
In front of everybody, you know, and I just moved his hand and I moved out of the way. And then the wife says, you know, how could she remember something like that? She was so little. And I said, no, tia. Oh, I remember. Hmm. I remember, you know, and I just looked at my mom and my sister because my sister was one that was like, you know, I don't remember nothing like that happening, you know, and that day is when she realized, oh my gosh, you know, this happened, you know, and this was in front of them. Can you imagine? I was at his mercy.
Is he still alive?
No, he passed away.
Good. And I'm sorry, you know, for people that, well, that's what you shouldn't wish death on somebody, but I'm sorry, you know, when you have people that are abusing, and then, you know, how long ago did he pass?
Probably about 7 years ago.
Yeah, so he stayed alive a long time. It almost makes you think, well, why did God keep him alive for so long? Why didn't God take him out like that? You know what I'm saying? So it's like, and I can get deeper into that one. It's just like, you just think, you know, oh, God needed to take that person out. But apparently, God kept him alive for a while, but then all of his, now he's gone. You know, it's terrible what things that happen to us, you know, in our childhood. Now, you had mentioned something about between the age of 7 and 10, you said that you knew that you weren't like other people. You weren't like other children. That you were different, you know.
Yeah.
And so tell me a little bit about how you knew that you were different. What do you mean? What do you mean by you thought you were different than everybody else?
Well, because I felt like I was tainted, like I was dirty. I felt like I was just this dirty kid, you know, and I just didn't feel like other kids, you know, that, you know, they would play, you know, together, they would play baseball, and I was always off to myself, you know, and growing up, I never felt good enough. I struggled a lot in school, you know, I struggled in my marriages. It was just like that throughout my whole life. It's like I felt like I'd been fighting all my life. You know, just defending myself all my life, you know, and just angry, so angry all my life.
Now, you were telling me that you tried to commit suicide when you were...
Yeah, I was 10 years old. I was 10 years old and...
What led you to that? And the reason I'm asking that is because there are children out there, and again, they keep to themselves. They don't interact with other people. They're all gothic and black. They don't get good grades, or they do stuff to themselves. They drink. They get on drugs. They get on methamphetamines, and our parents don't know why. And that's one of the reasons I brought Lucia here, because maybe somewhere out there, somebody will say, "Oh, my child." You know?
Yeah.
I wonder if. So what was the breaking point? What made you commit suicide?
I think one of the things was I wasn't doing good in school. And it was always so easy. I mean, I think my family thought it was funny to say, you know, you're so stupid. That's because you're stupid. That, you know, and I accepted it, you know. But it was just one of those times that you know, I felt like, man, I am stupid. I am, you know what I mean? What am I doing here? You know, I don't like this world, you know? I don't like this world. And I remember going into the restroom, and around that time, my mom had hurt her arm, so she had pain pills in there. And so I got a jar of Valium? Yeah, and I just took it all. And...
Because you just... People were calling you stupid, and you weren't paying attention, and
it's
you weren't
that I heard
getting
all
good
the
grades.
Time, you know, it's something that I constantly heard all the time was stupid. I was never called by my name. It was either, you know, itty, short for idiot, you know, or it was, or stupid, you're stupid, you know what I mean? And you accept it, you know, this is your new, this is your identity. This is what you grow up, this is your identity, you know? And even when you try to do something good, you know, like I was good at art class, you know, and I would draw something nice, it was never good enough, you know? And so anyway, that day that happened, and I had a cardiac arrest.
Oh, wow.
And so they called the paramedics and they took me to the hospital. I was in intensive care for 5 days. And I remember the doctor's daughter came to see me, and she had told me about Jesus, you know, and I told her, you know, who are you? And she told me who she was. And then my wrists were tied up because they said that I was trying to pull everything off of me. And she says, God has a plan for you. And I said, God doesn't like people like me. He doesn't listen to people like me. You don't even know me, you know? And she says, you know, Jesus loves you, you know, and he died for you, you know? And that was the first time I ever heard somebody talk to me about the gospel, you know? And so she said that she was gonna, she wanted to invite me to her church, and that she was going to stop by and pick me up, and just so that she would leave the room, I'm like, yeah, mm-hmm. you know, yeah, you do that, you know? And whenever she would come around, and I would tell her, I'm not giving those words, I'm not giving,
yeah.
You know? And I never went to church with her. But like about a couple of weeks after, my mom got a phone call, and it was the police department. And they wanted my mom to take me to the police department because of the narcotics. Mm-hmm. They wanted to book me, and they wanted to talk to her and the juvenile court. And what they had suggested is either put me in juvenile hall until I turn 18 or into a psychiatric hospital. Well, my mom chose a psychiatric hospital.
And how old were you then?
I think I was still 10, yeah, because it was just a couple
of years.
So
you're in a psychiatric hospital when you were 10 years old?
I was 10 years old. I was the youngest kid there.
Unbelievable.
The youngest
kid. And how long did you stay there?
You know, that's the thing, is that they told me it was only 3 days, and on the third day, I'm ready. I'm packed, I'm ready to go, you know, and everybody's telling me, where are you going? I said, I'm going home. I'm only supposed to stay here 3 days, and they're like laughing at me. You know, she's staying 3 days. You know, he says right here the minimum is a month. And I said, no, for me it's just 3 days. And they said, no. And so I asked my nurse, and I said, how long am I gonna be here? And she said, you know, a month. And I said, what?
But they wanted to make sure you were in there probably, and you wouldn't run away.
Yeah, you know, and I'm like, what? You know, so I call collect. You know, back then you can hear the people that are calling you collect.
Yeah.
And I'm like, mom, pick up the phone. Please pick up the phone, you know. And
she didn't.
You know, they wouldn't pick up the phone. They wouldn't pick up the phone. And I would be, you know, like crying, mom, please pick up the phone. I want to come home. I was just 10 years old, you know.
Yeah.
I just wanted to be with my mom. I just wanted to be home. And so finally the day came, and... But from there, my mom and dad decided to send me to Mexico for 2 months, you know, with my dad's family. And over there, I mean, it just got worse, because while I was over there, I noticed how they treated my sister. I mean, they were taking her to the mall and buying her stuff. And my dad has 10 sisters and 5 brothers. And like one sister after the other would pick her up and take her, and I would just stay in this one room. It just had a twin size bed with a TV, and I would just stay in that room, and she would come and show me what they bought her. And I'm like, you know, why aren't they
taking you?
Yeah, why did they buy me anything? You know, and she would say no. You know, and I'm like, why? You know, I didn't understand. Well, one day one of my aunts, she was on the phone. She didn't know I was in the living room. And she starts telling somebody, well, you should see how much they love Manuel. I guess Maria hasn't told them that's not their dad. And I was like, what? So this man that I thought was my dad ended up being my stepdad, and I never knew. You know, and it just crushed me because
oh, so
I loved my dad.
Oh, okay. So yeah. Your dad's family actually wasn't your Your blood family.
Yeah, no.
Oh.
And that's why they sent me over there with them.
I see.
You know, and that's what I tell people. If you're ever in a situation like that, you know, you need to be the one to tell your children, because there'll always be somebody that's dying to tell them, and they're going to tell them their way. So you guys do it. You know what I mean? You guys do it. I mean, a lot of times we make mistakes or whatever the case may be. You know, if there's a step-parent involved here, you be the ones to tell them the truth. Don't wait till somebody else does it, because it causes so much damage. You know, I mean, from that point on, my drug addiction began, and it began hard. I started sniffing paint, glue, you know.
And that was, how old was that?
I was, by this time I was probably about between 10 and 11, because it was shortly after I had got out of that hospital. So it was,
everything started. So why don't we do this? Let's go into to talking about that when we come back, right? And we'll go back into when you started the drugs, right? And we'll be back right back.
Join Techeetah Lopez and Hollywood in the Park's entire audience by advertising your brand, product, or personality with your commercial here. Email techeetah@gmail.com for more info.
Okay, well, we're back. Okay, so we had left off to where you started on drugs, you know, on PCP. At 11, 10 years old.
Yeah, very, very young.
So, you, how did it make you feel? Did it make you forget? Did it make you feel like, we already know what put you on all these drugs, right? Maybe we put you on these drugs because of finding out that your dad wasn't your dad. Mm-hmm. Finding out that people are not favoring you because, you know, you're like the black sheep. You feel like the black sheep of the family, yeah. You know? So tell me a little bit more about that part. So you went a lot. Did you ever try committing suicide after this?
Oh yes, several times. My arms are all cut up. I became a cutter.
A cutter?
Yeah.
So yeah. You just felt like hurting yourself? Is that what it is?
I think in the anger, you know, of never doing anything right, you know, and it's like I had this anger towards myself, you know, and it was just, I would just, you know, go to my room or go to the bathroom or just go to a place and just, you know, grab whatever and just begin to cut myself. And it just kind of relieved the anger. It just...
Because you were focusing more on the hurt on your...
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
And then after that, you met somebody? Is that you yeah. Here for love? And...
Yeah. I met my first husband, you know, and we ended up getting married. I was 16, 15 and a half, 16. Oh, wow. And I think my mom consented to it only because I was so involved in drugs and all the things that I was doing that... She was so afraid that one of these days I was going to, really kill me, take my life, you know, or overdose. So,
almost like saying, here, go ahead, get married, you know.
Yeah.
Keep your mind occupied. So. Yeah. And then is that when you got pregnant with Lena and Bertha?
That's when they came into my life. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was 17. you know, when I had him, 20 days later, I turned 18, you know, and that marriage lasted, but when I was 19 is when we split up. I caught him with somebody else, and so we split up, and it was hard for me because he had become my, I guess, like my security blank. I didn't go anywhere by myself, because here I was sober now. I didn't have drugs, you know, and I didn't have my husband. So now I had to face this world. I had to go sign up for welfare. It was hard for me, you know, and but I know that I wanted to prove to him that I can do it without him, that my daughters were going to be fine. And I went back to school. I joined Job Corps. Mm-hmm. I joined Job Corps, and I was there for 2 years. And
you were doing good.
I was doing good, but even in the process of those 2 years, it was hard because my family thought that they didn't believe I was going to school. They believed that I was just leaving my kids with my mom because I didn't want a responsibility, and they made it really hard. They made it really hard for me, and again, even going through Job Corps, I began to, those thoughts, you know, of suicide came again, you know, and nobody believes you, and nobody believes in you, you know, and
nobody encouraged you. Hey, good job.
Yeah, I didn't have that, you know, and I remember I finally decided to open up to one of the teachers, and I told her, you know, the thoughts that were going on in my mind, and so she sent me to one of the counselors, you know, and that counselor helped me so much, you know. I mean, she was so encouraging, and you know, she just helped me so much that when I graduated, there was about, I think there must have been about 580 students that graduated. And from those 580, only three were like the top students, and I was one of them.
Oh, wow.
And the fact that my mom and my sister were there, I mean, it was great. I didn't even know they were going to do that. I didn't know. They began to talk about this young girl and her struggles, and I'm like, oh, what is it? I wonder who it is. I know what she's going through. Yeah, and then when they called my name, I was like, what?
Oh,
you know, oh my gosh, I just, wow. And I turned and I looked at my sister and my mom, you know, and they were just like shocked, you know. So,
oh, that somebody knew your story, though.
Yeah, you know, and
So that sounds, you know, wonderful, and you're doing good, and you're doing well on your own. Mm-hmm. But then you had shared also a story with me, again, where, you know, let's turn it over to Lena really quick. Again, this is Lena. Lena, her daughter. This is one of the twins. One of the twins. You're the twin, is Bertha. So, when did you start experiencing, Lena, the things that were going on with your mom?
How did you feel about it? What was the very first thing you remember experiencing with your mom?
The suicidal thing?
Anything in general. Just anything in general. How did you guys realize that there was something wrong with your mom? How old were you?
Well, we were young. I mean, she was always angry. I remember that. I always knew she had a lot of anger inside of her. The suicidal thing, we were teenagers. That's the first time we ever saw that side of her, or really noticed it, really. I'm not really sure if it went away for a while, and maybe it came back at that time. But we were about 15, maybe, when you married Art. Yeah, I should mention names.
There are good arts and bad arts.
Yeah, good arts and bad arts. And he was an amazing stepdad. He was an amazing stepdad. I can't say anything bad about that part of him. But that's around the time, so it was about 15 when I started seeing the suicidal part of her. And I don't know if that answered your question, but that was the earliest that I remember seeing that part of her. But as far as like the anger part of her, we noticed that since we were little. I mean, with the, you know.
You had mentioned to me off camera that you're always worried about going to work.
I mean, going to school.
Yeah, I mean, we, as soon as they would start fighting, that's when her suicidal tendencies would rise. And we knew, I mean, it was just a given that her first instinct was to go to the kitchen and grab a knife, you know, or if there was no knives available, because that was our first thing is, if they're fighting in the room, we would go to the kitchen, grab all the knives, and hide them under our beds. And I know it's going to get emotional. And if she couldn't find a knife, she'd find something to break so that she would cut herself. So that was our routine. We had a routine. We would grab all the knives, we'd hide them under our bed. And
when then they were fighting.
Yeah, and then just start praying. And we weren't allowed to tell anybody. You know, his thing was, what happens at home stays at home. If you tell anybody, they're going to take your little brother away. And of course, we didn't want him to go anywhere, so we couldn't tell anybody. There was one teacher at school whose daughter was kind of going through the same thing. And so we really trusted her with everything. She knew everything. And she never told anybody, at least not that I know of. So she was just kind of our way of vent, our person to vent to. Mm-hmm. And she knows who she is. She kind of kept us sane, I guess. But yeah, you know, we, as far as, you know, Corcoran, I mean, it's a tiny town, so you, if there's a siren, an ambulance siren across town, you're going to hear it. So we couldn't focus on school. We would be at school, and if we heard the sirens going on, our first thought was, you know, my mom, you know, she tried to kill herself, or she, you know, something happened to her, you know. And, so yeah, I mean, I was sent to continuation because, you know, my grades were bad. but, you know, when you're...
So it affected you too.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah.
Now, I know this is really, really a touchy situation, and I know this is... It just gets me just thinking about it. But your mom tried to kill you and your sister along with herself at one time. What was going through your mind?
You know, when you have your own family, that constantly, you know, talks down to you, they don't see anything good about you. I mean, at that time I was working for the courts, I had my own apartment, had my own car. I felt like I was doing good, but I would always hear just this, you know, how stupid I was, what a, you know, effed up mother I was, you know, and I reached that dark place again, and I was just tired, I was tired, and I remember that I bought a gun, and I remember that I was tired, and I remember that my thought was, I wanted to take my life, you know, I was just...
But why your children?
Because I didn't want them to live with my parents, I didn't want them to be talked to the way I had been talked to for so long. I didn't want anybody to hurt them, I wanted them to be with me. But when I went into the room and they were asleep, and something told me which one first, you know, which one do you love the least? And I couldn't because I loved them so much. They were a part of me. It wasn't their fault. I just got tired.
But you didn't.
No.
Obviously.
No. And I remember just saying, God, if you're for real, help me. Please help me, you know. And now, like, when I hear them sing, you know, and I see my grandchildren, and I hear my grandchildren sing, or the funny things that my grandchildren say, I think, oh my God, everything this world would have missed out on. And it's like, you know, it's like, you know, Satan's been after me for years, you know, but that that when that happened, that's when I knew that I needed something, something that I needed, and I didn't know what it was, you know, and I was just so empty, so I was just a shell, you know, and that's what happened that day, you know, and I remember telling my sister, and she told me that I needed to go get my cards read. Mm-hmm. And thank you. And that I needed to go get my.
We're Mexicans here. We use paper towels.
And so.
So you got your cards read.
I went to get my cards read, and my sister says, "Look, she's gonna give you a little cup of coffee for you to drink." And then she's gonna read the cup.
Oh, like the tea leaves.
The tea.
The coffee leaves, or was it? It's called tea leaves. Reading the tea leaves.
I don't know, but it was a little cup of coffee.
Yeah.
First she did the cards, and then that's what she does that. And she began to tell me that I was really sad. There's a lot of sadness, and I said, well, yeah. Why else would somebody come to you?
Sadness.
You know. Uh-huh. And then she showed me a card. It was like a bunch of weeping willows. And then she showed me this one card, and it was of the devil looking down. He had his arms on his waist and looking down at this woman. The woman was on her, she was like on her knees, and she was like this. She was crying in front of him. And she told me, this is you, you know. And she says, what are you? And I'm like, what? She says, what religion are you? And at the time, I was Catholic. So I said, I'm Catholic. And she says, well, whatever you do to get close to your God, you need to do, and you need to do it fast, you know. And I said, okay. And it was really weird, because just before I got there, I'd stopped at a gas station, and I bumped into an old friend. I hadn't seen her in 10 years. And she invited me to her church. They were going to have a revival. Mm-hmm. And so I said, yeah, pick me up on Friday. So anyway, I was thinking, oh, my gosh, Margie just invited me to church.
She said pretty much the same thing, that I needed God, you know. And but anyway,
but God is in the Catholic Church.
Yeah. Well, see, but I was a Catholic and nothing was happening. I mean, I would go and my mom would tell me what to, you know, go and confess yourself. Go and I would confess myself, and they would tell me what to do, and I would do. And
in other words, there wasn't the guidance that you needed.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so then I went to. Oh, well, anyway, I wanted to drink my coffee, and she took it away. She goes, no more, that's it. And I'm like, that's it? And she goes, yeah. And I'm like, okay. So, and I was going to pay her. She goes, no, I don't want your money. You look for your God. And I'm like, okay. And so I left, and I'm like, well, that's weird, you know. But I waited for Marjorie to pick me up on Friday, and I went to a Christian church for the first time. And I really liked it because I understood everything. You know, I walked in and there was all these tattooed guys and girls and guys, and they were praising God, and I was like, oh, I'll never do that. And then they were speaking in tongues, and I was like, I'll never do that. You know, and then they were crying out loud. I'm like, oh, man, I'll never do that. You know, needless to say, I've done all of that. You know what I mean? It took a couple of months, and I accepted the Lord, and that's because somebody went to share their testimony, and she had been molested too. And I mean, right there, it's like, oh my gosh, I just broke, and I went and I accepted the Lord, and just something. I mean, it's like I had found forgiveness, you know, and it's like I just carried this cross. I just carried this ugliness with me. Mm-hmm. You know, and then from there, my life just continued as a Christian, you know. And, you know, when you give your life to the Lord, you don't live happily ever after, you know. It's a process. Mm-hmm. Sanctification is a process, and that's one thing I learned, you know. And
well, you know, like anything, you know, just because, you know, I remember one time when somebody asked me, I was doing a gig, you know, singing, and somebody, it was Victory Outreach.
That's the church I went to.
Yeah, Victory Outreach. And one of the guys came up to me, and he says, sister, when did you find the Lord? And I'm like, when did I find the Lord? Yes, tell us. Yes, yes. They all said, tell us your story. When did you find the Lord? And I'm like, I don't think I ever lost the Lord. I go, because I didn't know. You know, I was brought up. I was brought up very spiritual, you know, in a very Catholic home. But you know, there was a lot of guidance there, you know. And so we feared God. Yeah. We feared God. We knew God existed. We you know. So that's why I'm like, I didn't, you know. So that's why when I hear stories like this, you know, it touches my heart because I'm like, wow. That how there are individuals that don't think God exists, you know, or if bad stuff happens, they think, why God, why me? Well, that ain't got nothing to do with God, you know? There's God all over this earth, you know? And one, not one religion is the right religion. I believe that because I'm thinking if we were the only true religion, if Christianity was the only true religion, well, then that means the Chinese would be damned in hell, the Arabics would be damned in hell, the Indians would be damned in hell, the people that believe in different religions, they would all be sinners. They would all be devils, right? But like you were saying, just because you believe in God doesn't mean that everything is hunky-dory because wolves in sheep's clothing.
Mm.
Yeah.
So for those that are listening out there that are saying, after hearing her story, well, I'm in church and I'm still going through all this. Like you said, you go through that, right?
It's a process.
It's a process.
You know, it's a process because when you come to the Lord, there's still so much. I mean, if you think about it, there's things that make you turn to drugs and alcohol. You're not just born wanting them or craving them, you know. Well, those things, once you come to the Lord and you get sober or whatever, those things are still there. And God wants to get in there and excavate the cemetery in your heart. And he wants to uproot all of that. You know, like I talk about my past and all that. At first, I couldn't talk about it without throwing up.
Yeah.
I couldn't. For the longest time, I couldn't. You know, it was hard for me, you know. And now, you know, the Holy Spirit shows me when it's time to be able to talk to somebody about it. And when it's somebody like a program like this, you know, because there's a lot of people that go through this, you know. And I try to, you know, tell people, you know, when you let somebody, you know, into your house, be careful. Watch your kids. Watch them like a hawk. Don't trust everybody. You know, I don't care if it's your, you know, your brother, your sister, because there's even women child molesters. I worked for the judicial system for 7 years, and then I worked for a criminal attorney, you know, and there's women that are child molesters also. So it's not just men, and they're not just after girls. They're after boys too, you know, so beware, be with your eyes open, you know, be, what's that, wise as a serpent, you know, and that's what I always tell them, you know what I mean, and I share my story because there's so many cases out there, there are so many, you know, the wolf in sheep's clothing that you're talking about, when I met that, the one that Malena's talking about, you know, I thought, you know, I had been single for 10 years, single mother for 10 years, you know, from my second husband to him, it was 10 years, I'm like, okay, I did mention that I got married the second time, right?
Yeah,
okay, I got married the second time.
And you were married a third time, no?
I was married, this is my...
No, you didn't mention Tito's death.
Why didn't? My second husband, he was like, oh my gosh, he was like a total gentleman. Never had a man that, when I first met him, kissed my hand, you know, or that opened up the door for me when I got in or out of a car. I mean, perfect gentleman, you know. 2 weeks after he moved in with me, I realized that he had an anger problem, you know, and this was a rage that was unreal, you know. And it got, you know, it got really, really bad with him. And when I finally decided that the domestic violence was just, there was rape involved, you know, it was I mean, I remember looking at my daughter, and I would just tell my daughters, you know, close your eyes, just close your eyes, and they would be in a little corner. They were 5 years old, they'd be in a little corner, and they would just cover their ears and close their eyes, because I didn't want them to see what was going on, you know? And this was my Prince Charming. Hmm. This was my Prince Charming, you know, Mr. Perfect, you know? And I remember finally, you know, he had finally left, you know, and I thought, okay, good riddance. 2 months later, I find out I'm 5 months pregnant, you know, and I had a little boy, you know, and he found out, we ended up getting married, you know, and as soon as I have the baby, that same night that I came home from the hospital, the beatings began again.
Oh, goodness.
It began again, you know, and this time he pushed me, this one night he pushed me and I fell up against my son's crib. And I went to grab him because it startled him. And so when I went to grab him, he backhanded me, and then he just grabbed my son from, you know, his 90, and he just flung him.
The baby?
He hit the wall and landed on the bed. And I was like, oh my gosh, just let me hold him. Let me hold him. Please let me hold him. And he wouldn't let me hold him, you know, until I had to plead with him that I wasn't going to leave him, that I was sorry. I was sorry for what I had done, whatever it was, you know. And at that moment, I thought, you know what, I have to get away from this man because he's going to kill us. He's going to kill us. And so finally, I mean, there was a lot of other incidents that happened, but I finally decided to leave him. And, you know, when he left, 2 weeks later, I was watching a show with Oprah. This is around the time when Oprah first started coming out and talking about what had happened to her. And so I decided to ask my children if anybody had ever touched him in a bad way. Come to find out, he had molested my girls.
Oh.
You know.
But the... Lena, do you remember that?
How old were you? About 5 or 6 years old.
For to you and Bertha?
Both of us, yeah.
What were your mom?
That I don't remember. She wasn't around when he was doing it. I don't know that, but I don't remember where she was. I don't remember if she was in the house somewhere or out of the house. I don't know.
Does that affect you today?
Today?
Do you remember a lot about it?
I remember certain, I call them like certain scenes, but I don't remember everything. I remember enough to know that it happened. I remember the courts. I remember showing them, like, they give us a doll and showing them what happened with the doll. I remember telling my mom. I remember that. I remember her asking us. I remember telling her. I remember being afraid to tell her at first until she promised she would, you know, he wasn't going to hurt her. That stuff, yeah. Like I said, I remember certain incidents. Maybe not all of them, but I remember, you know, certain ones, specific ones. Bertha, too, she's the same way. She remembers certain things. But we did go to therapy, and that, I guess, helped us kind of forget some stuff. Yeah.
That's good. So apparently, you know, therapy is definitely a good thing to have, you know, when something like this happens. You know, a lot of people don't believe in therapy, right? But it's definitely a good thing.
Yeah, there was people that told me that why go through therapy? It's better that they forget about it. And it's like, no, because I never went to therapy, you know, and I never forgot about it. You know, it haunted me for the rest of my life, you know, and I didn't want that for my girls, you know. So we went to therapy, you know what I mean? Because I wanted them to have a healthy future, you know, healthy as possible, you know, their life to be different. I didn't want them to go through all the anger and pain that I had gone through. I didn't want that for them. I didn't want them to feel dirty or that, you know, that they were different from other kids. I didn't want that for them.
No, that was a good thing that you went ahead and you sent them to therapy. So, how are you now?
God is good.
Yeah.
God is good. I'm good. I'm doing really good. I'm
no I am. More husbands.
No more husbands. no more husbands. I'm doing good. I am seeing a therapist on a regular base. You know.
He or she?
It's a he.
It's a he?
Yeah. Yeah, they're trying to find a she because I really want a she.
I don't blame you. I would want a she too. Yeah. You know, if I had to see a therapist.
Yeah.
I talk to myself all the time.
Well, at least you'll never be alone.
I know. I'm like, Techeetah, you really think you should have did that? Yeah. But that wasn't good of you.
Well, leave her alone.
I had three of me.
Me, myself, and I. I put me in check all the time. You know, you're mean.
Whatever.
Yeah, but I see my therapist on a regular basis. I found out a few things about myself, you know, which I never believed in. You know, Bertha was the one that kept telling me, you know, you need to see a therapist. You need to see a therapist, you know, and I do have PTSD, you know, and I also have borderline personality disorder. And it all stems from my childhood, you know, from the domestic violence. But I think what's helping me a lot is my relationship with Jesus Christ. You know, my relationship with God, and I found that peace that surpasses all understanding, you know. I'm no longer angry, you know, and I want to live. I want to live. Now more than ever, I want to live. I want to see my great-great-great-great-grandchildren, you know what I mean? And I don't think about suicide anymore, you know. At one point, I thought about, you know, tattooing my arms, you know, so they can't see all the scars that I have. But then I thought, you know, that's my testimony. That's who I was. I'm not that person anymore, you know. And so I'm also studying because I want to be a life coach. You know, there's a lot of people that stay locked up in their home because they go through so many, you know, mental health problems. And they don't want to go outside their door. Well, these life coaches like myself will come to you, you know, and I believe that that's the calling that God has for me, you know,
And you're still young. You're never too old or never too young to start. It's always new beginnings. And everything in life, you know, there's just so much out there. You hear people that start at 71 years old. Or,
yeah.
You know, it's like, I started being a yoga instructor at 70 years old, or I ran my first marathon, or, you know, I became a such and such, you know. And it's never too old to start, you know. You're never too young to start, you know. And again, for those people that are listening to this, wherever you may be, whatever you took out of Lucia interview, think about it. If you're a parent and your children are acting this way, and even if you think, no, that can't happen to our kids, look inside your home, look in your backyard, look at your next door neighbors, look at school, look in the churches, right? Look everywhere. Look at your babysitters. And if your child is acting a certain way,
withdrawn.
Yeah, ask them. Or if you feel that you yourself as the parent has done something, right? And then talk to your child about it. Say, you know what? I did this. It has nothing to do with you. Is there something you want to talk about? Open up with them. If you're a child or you're a teenager and you're listening to this, right? Then tell your parents how you feel. Tell somebody how you feel. I know it's pretty sad when you have to go to a stranger to tell them, you know, but maybe they'll sit down with your parents and you're afraid that your parents might say, okay, you know, you were dreaming, you're hallucinating. That's like, oh, you're hallucinating. You don't know what you're saying, you know?
Yeah.
And then that's the worst thing you could tell your child is they're hallucinating, because then they become more effed up in the head, you know? Yeah. This is the only program that I have never used so many cuss words. I actually restrain myself. You know, but be open, whatever it is, because life is very big. We are born and eventually we're all going to die. There's nothing we could do about it. God is not going to help us from dying or living. It's our choice that we are going to die. But if we are going to die, let's all go out with a bang.
Let's go do things and visit places and experience life. When you see your next door neighbor or people on TV, for example, and you're saying, golly, you know, I could never do that. Yes, you can. Find out that person's story, and you'll see a lot of the people that have wealth or famous or whatever it may be, the painter, they've come from very sad stories also, and they have come up and they're now living good lives, or they went out there. Closed mouths don't get fed. So open your mouth. Is there anything you want to close with?
No, I just thank you so much for inviting me. It's always a pleasure to share my story, you know. God is good. Another thing that I'm really involved in, I'm involved with the Sword Sisters Alliance. And it's an alliance, it's an organization that what we do is we Leave No Woman Behind. And that's, you know, there's strong women that are out there, And what we do is we lift them up and build them back up and bring them back to that place where they should be, you know, because they lose themselves. We talked about, you know, you lose your identity, you know, and we try to help them find their identity again and who they are and what God's purpose is for them, you know, and because a lot of times they're like, you know, in the back room, you know, the back burner. Yeah. And they're such strong women, you know, with such courage and bravery, and we try to help them find themselves again. So God bless you. Thank you so much for the opportunity for us to share our story. I hope we helped you in some way. Thank you, Techeetah.
I want to thank you, Lena, for coming to City.
I know, she was so brave.
I know, she was so brave.
She's like, I don't want to. But I'm so glad you did. I am so definitely glad you did. Okay, so anyway, again, thank you both girls for coming.
Hopefully we can have you back on the show. Come out and hang with us and be a part of the audience. But until then, stay tuned for this commercial. We'll be right back.
She's been cooking all day, smells so good and saucy. Red love, let me get his haze in the morning with some eggs. Yeah, Malin's chili. Cause you are perfectly made with love. Malin's chili. Let me sing it again.
Oh, what a spanking. But man, does it feel good. Hello. Yeah, that's right. This is the show where we take you a funk above the rest. Where you hear the old funk. The new funk.
Take a look at the click, look at the shine, man. Look at how we dipping and moving it in the grind, man.
The everything in between funk.
Sometimes I find myself acting just like a Negro. That's right, I do it for the purpose.
We showcase new independent artists.
Let me make it good for you. I'm gonna make it good to you.
And yes, we even throw in a little affection.
Is this just a dream?
Yep, this is the funkiest show on radio.
So smart. it's me, Techeetah, your queen of salsa soul here on Hollywood in the Park, in my favorite segment I say all the time, because I like to eat. And we have Belen from Belen's Chili back again. My
Hi,
God.
Belen.
She gave us some great stuff to eat the other day. And you know what? I told her, girl, you're going to have to show me how to make your enchiladas, okay?
Okay.
So, matter of fact, you're going to make, today, you're going to use your big red one. Good girl, this is spicy, okay? I love this one. Mm. Okay, so for those who love the spicy chili, the big red one, this is the one I buy all the time. And then you're going to make the green enchiladas, right?
The green one enchiladas.
Yeah, with the green lime. I had some a neighbor come over, and I'm like, I hope you're hungry, because we're going to have plenty left over.
Yay, we do. We're going to make enough for everyone.
Yeah. Chicken. So you're going to go ahead, and again, remind everybody, where did you come from? What was your roots on everything?
My roots are German, Mexican, Spaniard. We basically like to cook together. We like to bring everyone together in the kitchen. Family that eats together stays together.
Oh, yeah.
And I wanted to incorporate, like you, people like spicy. And some of my family doesn't. And they like mild, so I made the green one sauce. So I want to incorporate that today with some chicken enchiladas.
And you can go on to Belen's Chili.net. Yeah, Belen'sChiliSauce.net. And we'll have it at the end of the program also. So I'm going to step aside, and every now and then I'll come in, and you'll hear me in the background. And you are going to show step by step how to make these the most easiest way, right?
Yeah, the way I make them and the way I've always made them at home.
Okay, great. All right. So take it away.
All right, guys, we don't need too many ingredients. We are going to do the green one sauce and the big red one. Basically, it is with chicken, so we're going to go ahead and take this on down. All right, so for the green one enchiladas, we're going to add the whole green one sauce. Pour it in there. Get it going. It's hot. That's what we like. We're also going to do the big red one. It is a little hot, so you can definitely dilute it. This is 1 cup of just tomato sauce, which is totally okay. And to bring the big red one sauce.
There we go.
That is good. And we have chicken, so we're going to add some chicken. I think it brings out more flavor when I cook the chicken into the sauce. That's what I like. You can do it however you like. Shake it up. Get my tongs. It's really easy. It's already shredded. I boiled the chicken and I added some salt. You guys can add whatever you like, and shredded it. And now I'm adding it to the sauce. I do need another utensil for this, so let me go ahead and get that real quick. Alright, so I'm going to go ahead and use a fork, because that's easy too. Go ahead and mix it around, leave that in there for a couple of minutes until you see it a little bit bubbly. That looks good. Oh, there you go. Okay, so the green one sauce right here, chicken, is cooking. Definitely want to incorporate that, let it get warm. The big red one sauce is also cooking. It's getting warm. Oh, this looks gorgeous. These are like Christmas colors. So we're going to go ahead and let that do its thing for a little bit. It smells really, really good. I like it. And then we're going to come on over here and do some tortillas. Basically, you're going to get a little bit of oil inside your pan. And grab a tortilla and cook it on both sides. As that's cooking, make sure this is getting really nice and bubbly. Wow, that looks good, you guys. Okay, that's ready. That is delicious.
That is so nice that Ivan helped you with the tortillas.
Oh yeah, I cannot multitask every day. This looks good. I love it. You want to mix it around, okay? Make sure that all your chicken is covered in the sauce. So basically, that's why we wanted the sauce to be this way. Ooh, delicious.
And you just used the red sauce and the
I like the green one sauce. Like I said, it's mild. And I do like the big red one sauce. That's spicy. It's concentrated. A little bit goes a long ways.
Mm-hmm. And then you don't use any other spices with it, right?
No.
Okay, great.
But I went ahead and did like the 1 cup of sauce, which is just tomato sauce. To dilute it. And we're going to go ahead and take that out. You guys shook it out. And then let's come over here. Start plating. I'm going to show you how to do the first enchilada. Alright, so I'm kind of universal with this. We're going to go ahead and put some chicken on this tortilla. Just like that. You don't need too much. Cheese. Yes, I put cheese in the middle. Because it looks nice. We're going to go ahead and roll it. See that? Push it down. Excellent. This is the green one. Okay, can I have another tortilla, sir?
Sure.
Thank you. And we're going to be doing this over and over and over until we get it all done.
Join Techeetah Lopez and Hollywood in the Park's entire audience by advertising your brand, product, or personality with your commercial here. Email techeetah@gmail.com for more info.
Gonna use that.
And you know what? That's one of the reasons why we have a lot of extra chicken, because of this type of drama. But let me get over here. I'm like, oh wow. See, and this is the part in the show where I say to myself, this is why we need the cleanup crew and this kind of crew and everything like that. But thank God we made extra chicken, right?
Yes.
Carry on.
Okay, so we're going to basically do the same as the green. We're going to add the chicken with the big red one sauce, and we are going to also finish off the green. So the green is completely ready. You're just going to basically put some cheese. Who doesn't love cheese, guys? Everybody loves cheese. Okay, so we're going to add some cheese to make it look pretty, and then with the green one sauce, you still have a little bit left over, we're going to pour it over.
So you put it in it, and then you put it over.
Yeah.
So that replaces the...
dipping it in oil.
The enchilada sauce.
Yeah, that's what it does.
Oh,
and it's good,
so it
like
makes
that.
Enchilada sauce.
Yes, that's the way it's going to work for you guys when you want to try it. So, we're going to keep plating.
And how much is a regular can of enchilada sauce in anyway?
I don't know. I haven't never really used enchilada sauce. I always just make my own.
Yeah, so I'm thinking, like, to make a whole thing of enchiladas, I think the can... are probably around $4 or $5 for the cans to make enchilada sauce,
yeah.
Right? And then and it's kind of like it has all those preservatives and stuff in it, right?
Yeah.
So here you have specials for $5 a jar,
yeah.
Right? So
Only Christmas specials.
Yeah. So for $5 a jar, wow. So I, and these are freezeable. I always freeze them.
Oh yeah.
So I would say it during the Christmas season or, but would
even
you,
even if you somebody
sees,
one.
If somebody sees this episode, will you valid the price?
Yes, only on your episode.
Okay, so.
She got me.
I would suggest you buy, on this episode, you buy a lot of her stuff, right? Mm-hmm. And then anything over 3 jars, she will ship it over to you.
Yes.
Right? And then freeze it. If you have a freezer, freeze it, because you will not regret it, right?
That's right.
I love this stuff. I buy so many jars. Matter of fact, you brought 2 cases over because everybody wants it for Christmas.
That's true.
Yeah.
Everybody wants it for Christmas. It's the time of the year to cook together.
Exactly. Ooh, this just looks delicious. Delish.
Thank you, Techeetah. I'm glad you guys are watching this, and I hope you do try my recipe. And I hope you guys do check it out on valenciachilisauce.net. And you guys can definitely have a good time making them. I have Ivan doing the tortillas. I'm plating with no drama. We are going to pop these in the oven. 400 degrees, 20 minutes. Let the cheese get gooey. Let it do its thing.
She's been cooking all day. Smells so good and saucy. Red love, let me get his haze. In the morning with some eggs. Yeah. The land's chilly. Cause you are perfectly made with love. The land's chilly. Let me sing it again.
Join Techeetah Lopez and Hollywood in the Park's entire audience by advertising your brand, product, or personality with your commercial here. Email techeetah@gmail.com for more info.
Okay, we are back. Amazing. These look so freaking good, Blend. So you have the, you literally have the green ones here, and all really nice and good, right? The green ones. And then you have the freaking red ones also. Right, and these are really, really good. So.
Yes,
you're going hot, girl. Do you know?
Oh my God.
See, when I first started this show, right? I had been cooking. I cook, as everybody knows. I did my own cooking shows. I really think I have they're burned off.
Oh no.
Yeah, I seriously think. Yeah, I have burned my fingers so much. I don't hardly have any feeling. Wow. Isn't that terrible? But I love to cook. I love to cook, and that's why I invite wonderful people to come and cook.
And she likes my sauce.
Oh, I love her sauce. Okay, I love her sauce. So again, this is the red one. Right. Good thing we brought some more.
Yeah.
I'm so serious. She goes, "Are you mad?" I go, "Oh hell no! I like that. That was a blooper, right?"
I know.
Yeah. And then we have the green love for this one.
Green one sauce.
No, sorry. Green one. I'm sorry. I don't have my glasses.
Yeah.
That's what happens, you know?
You could use any of the sauces for enchiladas, exactly. Just to let you know. But today we did do those two.
This is my favorite part. So I'm gonna get a little bit of this one.
Hmm. Yummy.
Yeah, this one and cut it in half because I'm gonna taste it. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, everybody. Those that don't know, I am so lactose. So I have been tasting, so
a lot of cheese.
Yeah, exactly. Uh-huh. So not good for a person that is lactose.
You want to help you?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay.
Well, let's try. Let's not drop it now. she likes dropping the red one.
I got a little slippery fingers.
I know.
Let's see. There you go.
All right. Okay.
Oh, that's cute.
Yeah. So the red one is extra, extra spicy.
Yes.
Right?
For you spicy
then,
lovers out there.
Yeah.
We also have the green one for you mild lovers out there.
Oh, wow. Let's
and we see. Have something in between, which is a flavor blend, but that is totally optional and up to you. You guys got to see how I did it.
Mmm. Oh, my God.
They're flavorful.
So much easier.
than doing the, it's just so much more.
Yeah, this is my way of doing it. I'm constantly busy. You guys know how my life is. And if you don't, I don't have a lot of time in the kitchen. So these are perfect. You save a lot of time. We make the sauce, put it together, put it in the oven. We did 400 degrees for about 20 minutes, and they came out really good.
Because you're just melting the cheese in.
Yeah, basically. Because everything is already cooked, as you've seen earlier.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why you're spending time with your family, your friends. This is a good dish to incorporate any time of the year.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, we have them right now, and only on Hollywood in the Park, Techeetah Show, we will be honoring the $5 for 16 ounces, free shipping if you buy more than three.
Oh, wow. Unbelievable.
BalenciaChiliSauce.net.
Mm-hmm. That's so good. Art, you need to come and taste that.
You know I do. You know I want to.
Yeah, come
to.
Over here.
Artie, the
one-man
party.
Artie, the one-man party. Oh, my God.
He is ready. We have some for you.
Mm. I'll take the halves that you didn't eat.
Come over here.
There you go. There you go. Enjoy.
Here.
There you go. We have to know.
Come on.
She always tells me she's going to cut this out anyway. So, this is it, guys.
He's such a ham.
Now I'm just going to stay here. Hey, guys.
Okay. And you know Ivan's going to jump in here a little later.
Oh, yeah. Got to get Ivan in here.
Get in the camera.
Ivan, get back here.
Get in the camera. My
Ivan, get over here. Get
hey,
in the camera.
You guys forget about me?
Yeah. We didn't forget about you.
Stop it. Get in the camera.
This is a family affair. Come here, Ivan.
Just eat it. Talk. Tell everybody how you like it.
Okay.
To be so
go,
freaking
guys.
Technical.
Look at this is awesome when you get everybody together to eat together.
Mm-hmm.
How is it, Ivan? It's a little spicy, see, a little mild. We got you.
Well, Ivan says, I'm getting
definitely
old.
The red one.
Oh yeah.
What the difference that was? Don't worry about it.
Mm.
The red one definitely hit the back of the throat, spicy, but it's good. The chicken, the tortillas. Who made the tortillas?
Ivan.
Chef Ivan.
Oh,
you know what? He literally put these perfect. They're not
too
crunchy.
They're not crunchy.
They're not too soft. They're just right.
Yes. Moist. Ready to go.
Well, I'm going to the green now.
Oh, yeah. I will do the whole
thing. Unbelievable.
You guys got to try this with your family and friends. Must try. Great recipes. They're really, really nice.
The
looking
still
good.
It still has a little kick to it as well.
Yeah.
Because I haven't
cool.
really had the green. I've had the red because that's how Cheetah pays me. one of these jars, I come over, I'll be leaving with
don't
one
do your
today.
Work.
Yeah.
Cameraman gets paid with sauce. But let's
why, is
sauce.
That something wrong with that?
And you know, the enchilada sauce, you don't know how long it's been in that can.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And, sorry, that's top of my mouthful.
It has a lot of preservatives.
Yeah, so.
And it's really runny like water.
And it has a lot of gluten in it, too.
Yeah, and this is thick and concentrated. If you guys noticed it, it's not runny like water.
Yeah, and that's what I like about it.
Yeah, you don't have to.
So,
add
yeah,
dude.
Nothing
oh,
on
wow.
my plate running now.
Delicious.
Mm-hmm.
That was wonderful. That's a good thing about doing camera here. I get to eat.
All right, thank you for liking my sauce and my enchiladas.
So, again. If you want any of these recipes, hit up Belen.
Yes.
Belen's chili. I know, Kat. He's so tall. He's a. He gets
Belen's
out of the
sauces.
Camera. Yeah. The Belen's chili sauce, you know, and hit
Not
her
yet.
Up. Or go ahead and hit me up. Again, it will be at the end of the at the end of the show. All her information on your Facebook, your Twitter, everything, right?
Yes.
And
Instagram.
In order for them. Again, they're $5. For this program, right? If you've seen this program, say, we saw you in Hollywood in the Park. Okay?
That is all the way.
We are going to bring you back.
Yeah!
We'll do another show.
But
another
no drama.
So what are you making next show?
We are going to be making some potatoes.
Potato dip?
Yeah, potato dip.
Oh, potato with cheesy potato dip. Oh, God.
Oh, that's going to be good. With the flavor blend.
Oh, my God. I'm going to need something, okay?
Yeah.
Get all this stuff out of here.
You
got to
come with
that's TMI.
Really...
That's your... I'm going to roll a road, okay?
Come with an appetite.
All right. Thank you. And we will be right back.
Whiskey sour, bubbling up the gear.
Join Techeetah Lopez and Hollywood in the Park's entire audience by advertising your brand, product, or personality with your commercial here. Email techeetah@gmail.com for more info.
Me, your queen of salsa soul, and in What Is Hip, today we have the gorgeous Isabel Mirasol, and she has these gorgeous macrame stuff that I wanted to go ahead and bring out. But first of all, your last name, Mirasol. I was calling you Marisol, like flower, you know, but Mirasol, where's that come from? What origin does that come from?
From Philippines.
Oh, you're Filipina. Yeah. So you have Filipina and Latina. So tell me all about your art. Matter of fact, we're gonna bring a few pieces out. And I'm doing the 70s theme right now because I love the 70s, and that's exactly where I actually got stuck at. And let me go ahead and bring out a piece here. Okay, so anyway, tell me what inspired you on this beautiful, beautiful piece here.
I made that one for my sister's birthday.
Yeah?
I kind of just started learning from like YouTube videos.
Really?
And, like, looking on Pinterest.
Well, honey, you did a great job. Matter of fact, you would, by the look of this stuff, it looks like you've been doing it like for freaking years, right? It's like, come on, look at how gorgeous is this, right? And they are absolutely gorgeous. And something like this is only $25? Wait, haven't you seen the prices on Pinterest?
Yeah.
They're like what? $1,000? I'm just kidding. They're like what? Like, they're like...
Probably like, it depends what you get, but like up in like the 60s.
Yeah, so $60 for something like this. And she makes them for approximately $25. And this is number 102. So if you're watching this program, we're gonna go ahead and put her website at the end of the program. And so watch out for that. But if you want anything that's beautiful like this, go ahead and say item number 102 and she'll know exactly what you're talking about. But let me bring out something else.
This one right here. Oh wow.
This is so pretty. And I'm gonna bring it up closer to you. And this one, again, is handmade by you. And golly, the beautiful detail in all of this is astronomical, honey. This is so pretty. And again, it is just like, wow, you know, you wouldn't even think that you just learned how to do this, you know? And it is such a pretty, 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 pretty piece. You know, and this one is item number 117, right? And this is only $22, right? So if this is something that you like, let them know item number 17, and this is really pretty. And I'm gonna go ahead and grab another one. Oh, this is the one I ordered. This one is so, so, so pretty. Look at how pretty this one is. Wow. And this one could go with a little, another little succulent plant, right? And how pretty is that? That is gorgeous. Mm-hmm. And this one is item number 115, and this is $20. And look at that. And you put a little succulent plant in there, or matter of fact, let me bring out the herb garden ones. All right, and hold it up. And this one, look at that. That is like a tri little, hold it up a little taller than I am. And this is like a little tri thingy. Right?
Plant hanger.
Yeah, a plant hanger.
Or whatever you want to put.
Yeah, herb garden, right?
Yeah, or wine bottle.
Give me a wine bottle. Winos, please. Actually, this is actually a dual life vitamin. So, and we could put that in there. Yeah, look at that. We could put a wine bottle in there or a bottle of vitamins, and we're going to put this up here. And look at that. So you could actually put a bottle of wine, two glasses right there, and again, or put three little herb pots in here, and it is absolutely beautiful. And again, this one's only $30 for the whole thing, and this is item number 111. So if it's something that you want, this is a beautiful item. Now this is one of my favorites, and this next one is the feather one. And this one is item number 101, like this, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Look at how pretty that is. This one is very gorgeous. And it is very, very beautiful. And this is item number, and this one's just, this is a, these are beautiful dream catchers. Mm-hmm. Beautiful, beautiful dream catchers. And again, this is item number 101, so these are only $25. So again, this is what is hip, back from the 70s. And you did really good job at these keychains. All right, we have blue, we have beige, we have mustard, yellow, right? And we have burgundy, and these are cute, cute keychains. They are absolutely gorgeous, right? And these are how much?
$8.
Mm-hmm. And she makes them for $8, and they are so pretty. Look at that. And then, you know what? This one, I like the detail on these ones. The how you did the pretty detail. Look at how pretty that is. That is absolutely gorgeous. Isn't that pretty? Yes. Mm-hmm. So again, we're gonna go ahead and put all her information at the end. So like that, if you want any of Isabel's beautiful macrame items or anything like that, go onto her Instagram or her Facebook and you can go ahead and get something like that. And this is what is here.
Join Techeetah Lopez and Hollywood in the Park's entire audience by advertising your brand, product, or personality with your commercial here. Email techeetah@gmail.com for more info.
She's been cooking all day. Smells so good and so safe. Red love, let me get a taste. In the morning with some eggs. Yeah.
Give me the red one.
All right, now.
In the morning, fever all through the night. Baby, phone. So what kind of phone is it?
Call it.
LG.
Call it.
LG?
Yeah.
It's an LG phone.
Okay.
Call it.
And it got the pictures of me in it.
Yeah.
A lot of them. You took out those really bad ones though, right? So go ahead and if you see the phone, return it back to the table where the CDs are at. We had a request for Bésame Mucho. There she is. She's been asking me for Bésame Mucho all night long. She says she loves Bésame Mucho. I'm gonna slow it down a little bit. I know it's a little hot. But you know what? I like getting all hot and sweaty anyway. Yeah. I just gotta make sure it's in my honey. We're on the stage. Also on the CD.
Techeetah Lopez, give her a big hand there.
Thank you very much.